On today's show, Zack Ford, the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org, talks about Mika Brzezinski's use of the word butt boy, Kevin Hart's Oscar-unworthy homophobic tweets, and the use of the word queer in the LGBTQ community. Founder and editor-in-chief of Who, What, Why, Russ Baker, on George Herbert Walker Bush's Sins Against Democracy. Russ Baker is also author of Family of Secrets, published by Bloomsbury Press in 2008. Gore Vidal calls Family of Secrets one of the most important books of the last 10 years. Family of Secrets describes alleged connections between the Bush family with the Central Intelligence Agency. In his book, Russ asserts that President George Herbert Walker Bush was linked to the Watergate scandal and the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Then comedian Dave Sirus says YouTube has a PewDiePie problem. Felix Arvid Uf Kjellberg, YouTube's most popular vlogger, otherwise known as PewDiePie, well, he continues to dabble in white nationalism, alt-right, anti-Semitic, neo-Nazi behavior. We talk about that, as well as Maria Butina pleading guilty. David Pecker and the National Enquirer admit to making the Karen McDougal payment to help Trump's presidential campaign. And Michael Cohn gets 3 years in prison. Kevin Bartini looks back at the week in Weird and tells us about men who vape Viagra, how Christmas Eve is the most common time of the year to suffer a heart attack, nutritionists say we should eat more dirt, and a human heart is found on a Southwest airline jet. It's 3 a.m. on Friday, December 14th, 2018. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show, so let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
George Herbert Walker Bush died on November 30th. He was the 41st president of the United States. He was the 43rd vice president, the 11th director of the CIA. During the height of Watergate, Bush was chairman of the Republican Party. He served as the American liaison to China, the 10th ambassador to the United Nations, and served two terms as a United States congressman representing Texas 7. A lot of kind words were said about the man. His funeral was a national event. Surprisingly, a lot of negative things were also said of the man, not just on Twitter, but in well-respected magazines like The Nation and over at The Intercept. Jeremy Scahill wrote some scathing thoughts about the blood on the former president's hands. I thought people would wait a little longer, but they didn't. We waited. For more on this, we're joined by Russ Baker. He is the founder and editor-in-chief of the website called whowhatwhy.org. It's a nonprofit organization. They do not accept any advertising. Russ is also the author of Family of Secrets, which is a comprehensive look at the Bush dynasty. It's real reporting, no conspiracy theories. Russ is a graduate of the Columbia School of Journalism. He's taught there. Everybody should buy Family of Secrets because it's an honest look at the Bush family, fact-based, and you can draw your own conclusions. And, Russ, thank you for joining us. The conclusion I drew from reading Family of Secrets is that the Bush family has done horrible things, but they have no problem sleeping at night because they filter their actions through the prism of, we did these things to protect our way of life here in the United States. Is that fair? They had no qualms about what they did, right?
That's right. I think they come from a background and a circle that believes that the primary purpose is to uphold certain principles, values, and interests that serve themselves and their immediate group. And I think they, in some way, delude themselves to think that, along with the sort of trickle-down theory from Reagan, that this somehow benefits the rest of us, that we don't know what's good for us and are not really capable of managing ourselves. And so they are sort of self-appointed to do that and, of course, to take a very, very large management fee in return.
They put a gentle face to some really nasty stuff. Can you get to the top in the United States without behaving the way they did? I mean, were they any worse than, say, the Kennedys?
Oh, I think they definitely were. I mean, it's all very subjective, of course, but, you know, I've spent a long time studying the Kennedys, and my views on them have changed. I think one of the problems is we're so shaped by what we hear and read, as opposed to being able to look into things for ourselves and reading primary documents, interviewing people, and so on. And when you do that, you're often shocked at how far off the mark the conventional narrative is that we're provided. And that's what I found with the Bushes. That's what I found with the Kennedys. Family of Secrets is about both families, as you know, and how their fates intertwined in fascinating and indeed shocking ways that have never been reported. You might call it a kind of a clash of dynasties. And I think the fundamental thing is that John and Robert Kennedy somehow came out, probably in a way despite their father, came out of their formative years with a general sympathy for the underdog, and I would say the Bushes most certainly did not. And I think everything kind of emerges from those two disparate worldviews, their two disparate senses of the rest of humanity and how they relate to it.
The Bush family was involved with the deep, dark state. Was Kennedy involved in any way with that?
This term has been sort of hijacked, and a perfectly good term has been ruined. The term deep state was a kind of an academic term, came out of Turkey, was used very much in political science education, and the concept was basically that there was a kind of a class that inhabited some of the upper reaches of society, and that these people often found themselves into major institutions, including government, and that they tended to understand their shared purpose in certain ways, and that this kind of steered the ship in unseen ways. Now, this is not really as kooky as it may sound. It really makes a lot of sense. I think in most institutions there are, to do well, you have to understand the guiding principles of that institution, whether it's a club of some kind or it is a university faculty or whatever. You know, certain amounts of sort of dissent and talking independently is tolerated as long as it doesn't get in the way of the show. And, you know, whether it's government or the military, certainly intelligence organizations, other secretive outfits, and then it extends out to ones that the Bushes were very interested in, such as the secret societies. Many, multiple generations, I think four generations of the Bush family, got into this very exclusive senior society at Yale, Skull and Bones. People dismissed that as unimportant, but in fact, they considered it very, very important. This was an exclusive opportunity to be invited into an elite circle where bonds of allegiance were sworn, oaths of secrecy were taken, and they were to last for life. Now, that doesn't mean that you don't see people from there being Democrats, like John Kerry, but even John Kerry himself often held his fire, often wouldn't talk about certain things, and even when he was running for president against George W. Bush, and they both were alumni of this group that takes, I believe it is 14 people a year, they asked him about it. He said, "I can't say anything, it's secret." Well, John F. Kennedy chose not to be involved in those types of things. He warned that, as president, that these kinds of memberships, secret memberships, were a bad thing for democracy. They were a bad thing, and that people in government should not have multiple loyalties. The only loyalty should be serving the American people and the country. And so these kinds of things, and there are many of them, and if you look at the Bush family, you see that the elitism extended in so many directions. They had business relationships, investments, these sort of secret collaborations in societies, in intelligence work, and I assume we're going to be talking about George H.W. Bush and what I learned about his secret, not public, but secret intelligence work. We see it in their social associations, marriages, who they married, all kinds of alliances, and this carried on throughout their lives. I think this factor, which was so big in this country for a long time, it may have been at its apex sometime around the 1950s, 1940s, 1950s, which is when we saw George H.W. Bush really coming into his own. And so that really was one of the dominant factors. And if you look through the government, you'll see that even when John F. Kennedy was president, almost to a person, if you look at the leaders of his national security team, if you look at the Secretary of State, if you look at the Secretary of Defense, and on, they come from an extremely narrow swath of this country. You don't see it to that extent, I think, today. I think it is a more diverse group. And you asked, could you become president without sort of being party to this sort of thing? I mean, I think presidents vary. Somebody like Jimmy Carter came from a very different background, a Harry Truman. But again, they sort of had to play ball, too. Harry Truman was very active in a somewhat secretive fraternal order, the Masons, a very secretive fraternal order, and that helped him in his career. He was sort of handpicked and approved by people who happened to be other Masons who felt that this was a trustworthy guy. Now, that's not saying that he was or was not a good president, but it certainly complicates things.
He gave us the NSA. Harry Truman.
That's right. The National Security Act of 1947, which created the NSA, the CIA, it created the modern Pentagon, it created all of these things. It really all came out of that one moment. And to be fair about it, and I spent a lot of time researching this, I think Truman was tricked, because Truman was really somewhat wary of this. But a group of people, including Alan Dulles, very close friend of the Bush family, who went on to be the longest-serving head of the CIA, and then some of the folks who came out of the OSS, names like E. Howard Hunt, Patrician Averill Harriman, Democrats and Republicans alike, friends of the Bush family from business and their investment banking firm, Brown Brothers Harriman, all these people were sort of key in these things. The person who may have been the real architect of this national security state, and by the way, not doing it on his own, but doing it on behalf of these networks of people who were like-minded. Robert Lovett was, again, out of those same circles. And as I recall, I may have this wrong, but I think he went to Yale. Can't remember if he was in Skull and Bones, but you know, he was certainly he was a partner in Brown Brothers Harriman, and he actually, Robert Lovett's family worked for the Harrimans, helping run their Union Pacific Railroad. So a lot of this stretches way back.
Brown Brothers Harriman was the firm that Prescott Bush eventually ended up running. He was the father of George Herbert Walker Bush, and he became a senator from Connecticut.
That's right. And so in Family of Secrets, I trace all this, how Prescott Bush's own father ran a company that made goods, among other things, for the railroads. And he was doing business with, at the same time, two feuding branches of the Rockefeller family, became involved with the military-industrial complex. This is the father, Samuel Bush, was invited into the Woodrow Wilson administration, where he was the head of small arms procurement. There was some double-dipping there, small arms procurement for World War I. All these people line up, having been huge advocates of going to war at a time where America did not want to get involved. World War I was not World War II. The issues were very, very different. And Woodrow Wilson was quite adamant about not getting involved. And they all played a role in pressuring him and, in a sense, working to divide the spoil. So I think it's very important to understand that how far back these things go. And then, of course, we see Prescott Bush. He goes off to Yale, gets into Skull and Bones, becomes friends with the two Harriman boys, Averill and Roland. Their father dies, and they're young, but they inherit his empire, and they need someone to run it. And Prescott Bush gets married to Dorothy Walker. Her father, George Herbert Walker, is one of the more prominent people in the financial markets west of the Mississippi, and they introduce him to the Harrimans, and they move him out to New York, and he becomes the guy who's running their operation. He merges them, Harriman, into Brown Brothers, becomes Brown Brothers Harriman. So all of this stuff is extremely linked, and it goes way back, and it's got tentacles all over the place. The U.S. ambassador to Moscow. I guess it was St. Petersburg around the time of the First World War, when you still had a Tsar. He was the governor of, I want to say, Missouri, who was basically politically supported and funded by George Herbert Walker. And so their guy was over there working with the Tsar. And so, I mean, you know, and then you flash forward 5, 6, 7 generations, and the same kind of deals are still going on.
This is a conspiracy of money and power and people working for the same thing. Let's talk about 1975. In 1974, Nixon resigned, and that was the year of Watergate. 75 was the year of intelligence, when our government was forced to address the violations that our intelligence community was guilty of. And we had the Church Committee, the Pike Committee, even the Rockefeller Commission. Vice President Rockefeller was put in charge of a commission to look into intelligence, to clean up the CIA. Gerald Ford appointed George Herbert Walker Bush to run the CIA. George Herbert Walker Bush was an outsider who was brought in to clean it up. Is that a fair statement?
Well, yeah, it's sort of an understatement, because he was a man who really, even if you go back and you read the articles from that period, people kind of said, huh, well, that's a surprise. This is really, completely unexpected, because he had no background. He had no experience. He'd never done anything. Nothing on his resume suggested that he was in any way, shape, or form qualified to be involved with running a spy agency. So it was just strange. I mean, this was a man who really didn't have a lot. I mean, he'd been in the oil business, and as I show in Family of Secrets, he ran a strange oil company, hopefully we can get to that, which never made any money, but somehow always got funding from Washington. He traveled to strange places where there was no offshore oil drilling, and he dealt with a strange bunch of people, and that's all fascinating. Love to get to that. But in any case, he was in the oil business. As you say, he was a couple of short terms in the House of Representatives. His mark there was really protecting the oil depletion allowance for the oil people in Texas, not intelligence. And then he was an undistinguished ambassador to the UN briefly. He was sort of peculiar choice to be the head of the Republican Party, and then sent off to China as an envoy who was cut out of all the action by Henry Kissinger. So, you know, what did this man bring to the table? He wasn't considered to be a heavyweight or anything. And here's this agency, and the Church Committee in particular, run by Senator Frank Church, had the CIA absolutely up on the coals, and they were just being singed by these revelations about how out of control this agency was, that it was an active entity that was going around the world overthrowing governments, having people assassinated. None of this was known by the American people prior to that, and so the CIA's very existence was threatened. And at that moment, they chose to bring in George H.W. Bush, and what he did, he was only CIA director for a single year, what he did was he went after the CIA, went after a church, and really kind of falsely accused these members of Congress of being responsible. It was disinformation, basically, and put them on the defensive with the public, and really damaged and weakened the probe. And so you ask yourself, well, why this guy, and why would they bring him in to do that? And that always struck me as strange, and I think that was one of the motivating factors for me to spend 5 years, some very long days, I might say, traveling the country, going to archives, digging things up, talking to people, trying to understand the unusual role of the Bush family in American history, and to figure out why they had been given these extraordinary opportunities. And what I found, David, really changed my understanding of American history, and it made me realize what a poor, poor, poor job the establishment that we, the sort of educational establishment writ large, including academia, textbooks, the media, all of this, what a poor, poor job museums do in really finding out how things really work and leveling with us about the fundamental forces shaping that trajectory.
Was he an outsider, George Herbert Walker Bush, when he took over the CIA? Was that his first experience with the CIA?
Well, you know, that always seemed strange to me, as I said, and so my approach to journalism is that what you're looking for is rationality. You're looking for logic, and if you're being told, well, this doesn't make any sense, but you should accept it, no, you shouldn't accept it. And so my whole idea, and that's why I started whowhatwhy.org, because I wanted to, I felt the need for a news organization that wasn't afraid of breaking with the consensus, of asking tough questions. And so I asked tough questions about that. And what I found in months and years of digging, I gradually began piecing together this picture of an alternate sort of career of George H.W. Bush, and that, in fact, he was a very different person than we understood, that he was not this neophyte, that he was not really an oil man or a congressman, that, I mean, he was nominally those things, but that those things essentially were what you might call commercial cover, as the lingo goes in the spy business, that those were cover for what he was really doing, which was that he was himself working under very deep cover for the Central Intelligence Agency, doing all kinds of things for not just years but decades prior to being named CIA director.
Well, he would be a prime choice for the CIA. The CIA came out of the OSS. They were looking for guys from Yale, skull and bones. He was a war hero. He was the son of a financier and senator from Connecticut. He'd be the perfect CIA operative. Was he working out of Texas in 1963?
Yeah, so all of the indications, as I put them together in the book, is that he was working intelligence from his time as a Navy flyer in World War II and then in the oil business. And so then we get to 1963, and we get to 63 because it's sort of interesting. If you read his own quasi-memoirs and those books written about him by his friends, they kind of, you know, you see American history happening and happening and happening and mentions of where he is and what's going on. And then suddenly it's 1963, and they basically don't even mention that the President of the United States is assassinated in Texas, which is where Bush has been running for at the time, is running for the United States Senate on the Republican ticket. And they don't mention, and he doesn't mention, this incredibly convulsive event. I thought that was strange. And then I learned from another book that he, in an interview, had been asked where he was when Kennedy was shot, just a sort of a softball question, just, you know, asking him, you know, what do you remember about, you know, I don't know, the moon landing and this and that, the kind of things you might ask somebody who'd had an interesting life. And so when they asked him about 1963, he basically wasn't expecting that question, and he said he couldn't remember where he was. And so that got my attention, not so much trying to address the fact that he couldn't remember where he was, but just addressing the fact of where was he. Mm-hmm. And so I began looking, where was he? And I spent several years on that, and I did find out where he was. And it's, again, it's all in Family of Secrets, but in a nutshell, he was in Dallas. Now, he not only was in Dallas, but he left Dallas right around the time of the shooting, and he made his way to a nearby city. He was flown actually on the private plane of a man who I've since learned was himself involved with international U.S. intelligence operations. He was flown to another town where he'd arranged to give a speech to a Kiwanis club, and at 1:45 p.m., which is an hour and 15 minutes after Kennedy was shot, he stood up and said, "I know I'm supposed to speak, but the president's been shot. I don't think I should say anything." And he went right to a phone, and he called the FBI. And we know this because this is all in declassified government documents that he probably either didn't realize were around or didn't expect to see the light of day. And they showed that he called the FBI.
He was not in the government at that time.
In 1963, he was not. He was a private citizen.
A private citizen who could pick up a phone
chairman.
Call.
Yeah, he was a chairman of the local Republican Party in Houston. Mm. And he picked up the phone and he called the FBI. Astonishingly, now keep in mind, this is a man who couldn't remember where he was that day, a private citizen, and he called the FBI, and he called the FBI office, not in Washington or in Dallas, which would make sense, but in Houston, where he was from, and he got a man on the phone, and he said to him, he had identified himself fully, including his address, so we know it was him, and he said he was an oilman, and he said, I'm in Tyler, Texas. What's important about that is it was not Dallas. And he said, I heard the president was shot, and I wanted to be helpful to the investigation. I know a fellow who was making threats about the president, and, you know, you ought to check him out because maybe he was involved. And so, of course, this is extraordinary because how would you forget that you had called the U.S. government to say you might have information on the murder of the president?
So are you suggesting that he was trying to place himself miles away from the assassination by calling the FBI? Is that the purpose of that call?
Well, I don't want to suggest, but I think I have one chapter that's just on this call. And I mean, there you see the document. He definitely made the call. I discovered that the man who took his call, although he didn't say so in his report, the FBI agent was actually, he and his brother were close friends of Bush. I found that interesting. You're calling your friend to give a report. I then discovered that that the man that he was naming was somebody he knew well, I mean, better than he said on the phone, and that, in fact, he knew the man, and this is really where it gets kind of wacky. He gave the report, and then instead of that man being immediately picked up, he was driven, that man, the suspect, was driven by a friend of his to the local Secret Service office, where they then spoke to them, and they explained that he couldn't have done anything because he was with the other man. Well, the other man who cleared him was, are you ready, was George Bush's own assistant at the Harris County Republican Party, and the answer was no, this man was making lawn signs for the GOP, so no, he couldn't have been involved. So now you've got Bush calling to offer this supposed tip, getting his name on the record. I had to conclude, and I think most people would conclude reading this, that call was a red herring, or whatever you want to call it, a deliberate distraction, and the only purpose you could figure out for that call was to get it in government records that he was calling from somewhere other than Dallas. And mm-hmm. once I established that he'd just come from Dallas, and then in his call, he said that he was in Tyler, Texas, and he was planning to go to Dallas, and he would be staying at the Sheraton Hotel. But what I discovered was he had just been in Dallas, had just stayed overnight at the Sheraton Hotel. And you don't get that mixed up the next day. He clearly wanted to reorder events so that if anybody asked about him, he could say, well, you know, I mean, I called the FBI. I was trying to be helpful. I said I was in Dallas. I said I was staying at the Sheraton. Well, no, you weren't. You were telling the story backwards.
The Bush family, in their heart of hearts, would say, yes, George Herbert Walker Bush knew that there was something going on because he was a CIA operative, but he wasn't high up to know the full extent of it or to stop it, and that he probably didn't want Kennedy assassinated, but he knew that there were cells within the CIA who were planning it.
Yeah, that's a reasonable thing. And then I reply with another thing that I dug up, which is a letter from Prescott Bush, George H.W., by the way, his nickname in the family is Poppy, so I refer to him as Poppy in the book to avoid confusion with his son, of also George. But Poppy, his father...
I mean, he's not called Poppy because he was involved in the heroin trade in Vietnam.
Not that I know of.
Okay.
No, he was called that as a young man. You know, the fact is that his father, of whom he was scared but also always seeking approval. His father, Prescott Bush, was a U.S. senator who was involved with oversight of and very involved with the operations, the secret operations of the CIA in those years, was an extremely close friend and also business associate of Alan Dulles, the CIA director who John F. Kennedy had fired. And I found a letter from Prescott Bush to Alan Dulles' widow, I believe it was 1969 when Dulles died, and he said, The whole note, and this is strange, this is when you're sending a condolence note, the whole thrust of the intelligence note was, I was so mad at the Kennedys for what they did to Alan. Now, you know, I don't know. That letter is 6 years after Kennedy was killed. Lots of other things happened.
The Bay of Pigs you're talking about. Blaming Alan Dulles for the Bay of Pigs?
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, Kennedy, I think, had always wanted to get rid of Dulles. He had kept him on because he was advised, you really can't get rid of this guy. But I think he had always intended to get rid of Dulles because, as a young man, Kennedy's own values, and this is, again, not reported well, even by these so-called liberal media, they always try to convince you he was a hawk on Vietnam, he was this, he was that. It's basically untrue. And if you do the research, you find out it was untrue, and you find out that he was from a young age, he was a big fan of self-determination and independent forms of governance for other countries, and these were the very countries that produced the raw materials and generated the markets that these large American corporations needed, the same corporations that used Brown Brothers Harriman as their bankers, that used the law firm that Alan Dulles and his brother were attorneys in, and so forth. It was this whole small network with United Fruit and the big mining companies and what have you, and they were their people. The Bushes were their people. And so the likelihood that that George Bush had a different viewpoint, that radical different viewpoint from his father, who really very clearly hated the Kennedys, I think is almost nil.
I've heard, and then we should move on, that George Herbert Walker Bush may have warned the Kennedys about efforts to assassinate Jack.
That I've never heard.
Yeah. Germany has a past. A messy past. What is the difference between Germany and the United States in terms of how we look at our history? We're almost treated as infants when we're taught history. And how are the German people post-World War II taught history?
The situation there has changed from time to time, but Germany did make a major effort. I think some of it was probably imposed on them by the victors, but Germany has made an effort and now, I think, overall continues on its own to try to educate its people about the dangers of tyranny, of fascism, of all of these things, and also just of the atrocities that the country committed and that the people supported as much as they knew about what was going on, which I think was a fair amount. I think Germany, you know, has owned that, and that was appropriate and brave. Some other countries have had what you call truth commissions, Argentina, Guatemala, and so on, where horrible things happened. The United States is one of those countries that has never wanted to do that. Historically, until fairly recently, there never was a very good job of exposing what the white man did to the Native Americans, really not fully exploring the subjugation of the African and the treatment really to the present day of the criminal justice system and so on. So our country has never really had a reckoning with what it has done. And certainly we're always taught that America is good and is virtuous, and there is almost no coverage of the fact that the U.S. has bases in more than 100 countries, that people are still dying from cancer believed to have been caused by weapons of mass destruction that George H.W. Bush put into play in Iraq in arguably the first Gulf War, an unnecessary war, or that his son put into play in a definitely unnecessary war, the second Gulf War or invasion of Iraq. So we don't deal with these things, and we're one of the most heavily propagandized countries in the world. We're constantly bombarded. We don't even think about it anymore, about salutes to our military. That's not necessarily normal. Very, very few countries do that because, of course, if somebody serves in an honorable conflict like World War II or something, it's understandable that they would be honored. But the fact is that many American wars and many American activities have not been honorable. People have been involved for a whole range of reasons, including the fact that they are often coming from hard-scrabble financial circumstances, and they are wooed into the military, sometimes under misleading circumstances, promised an exciting time and compensated for them comparatively well, offered an education and student loans and all that. So there are all kinds of things bound up with this, and it's just not discussed. And so I think we really are in denial. And if I may say, the kind of things you and I are talking about, David, they're all of a piece.
Mm-hmm. I think far worse than the Kennedy assassination is Contragate. Now, you had a vice president, George Herbert Walker Bush, who claims he was out of the loop throughout all of Contragate, even though he was a former CIA chief. And it was the CIA that was initiating plans to start selling arms to Iran and give the proceeds to the Contras. How much do you know about George Herbert Walker Bush's involvement in Contragate? I know that Lawrence Walsh, the prosecutor, concluded that George Herbert Walker Bush covered up his own involvement in Contragate, refused to turn over evidence, and then when he became president, shut down Lawrence Walsh's investigation by pardoning the people who were convicted and pardoning, I believe it was Weinberger, former defense secretary Weinberger, whose trial hadn't even come up yet. George Herbert Walker Bush pretty much shut down the Contragate investigation when he became president.
The Iran-Contra thing is very typical of off-the-books operations that have gone on throughout at least fairly recent American history, with where the American people had never been informed of something, had never been given a chance to weigh in on it. Our elected officials had not been informed of it, and they had simply gone around and used methods that typically, whether it was Iran-Contra or other things, somebody made a decision that there was a threat, and this was, again, to business interests. The Nicaraguan Contras were seen as a threat to all of these U.S. financial interests throughout Latin America. They were worried, again, about, if you had other regimes. I don't know that they cared that much about Nicaragua itself, but cumulatively, of course, the tremendous resources that we depend on there, and they didn't want anything to happen. So they said, this, we're going to nip this thing in the bud, and we're going to fund it off the books. And so they typically would use things ranging from war booty loot to any kind of convertible thing, whether it was gold or valuable fine art, or in some cases it's been documented, particularly with Vietnam, Laos, and so forth, drugs. So that kind of thing was part and parcel of what it was to be involved with CIA and with covert operations. When Bush was CIA director, he was running all kinds of stuff like that. So this was just business as usual. So the bottom line is that could a man like him, who'd already been CIA director and who had involved in covert operations over the years and who understood this was how they did business, not know what was going on? No chance at all.
Right. Right. We've been joined by Russ Baker. He is the editor-in-chief and founder of whowhatwhy.org. And everybody should go there. It's a great, great website. And they are a nonprofit organization. They don't accept any advertising. He is the author of Family of Secrets, a comprehensive look at the Bush dynasty. Real reporting, real journalism. I cannot thank you enough for taking time to be with us.
My pleasure, David. Always enjoy it.
Thank you. Can you stay on the line for 1 second?
Sure.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Time for Dave Sirus. Hello, Mr. Sirus.
Hey, David. How you doing?
So much to talk about. Kevin McCarthy of California, the leading Republican, says it would be stupid for a government shutdown, which Donald Trump is threatening. The Senate passed a resolution proposed by Chris Murphy and Bernie Sanders to pull U.S. support from Saudi-led forces in the war in Yemen. That's the first time the War Powers Act has been invoked since 1970.
And that is, of course, specifically about Khashoggi, right?
Yeah. Maria Butina has pled guilty in a D.C. federal court to conspiracy charges.
Who apparently it may not have actually prostituted herself, might just be a spy.
Mm-hmm. Donald Trump says he never directed Michael Cohen to break the law after Michael Cohen was sentenced to 3 years in prison this week. U.S. health officials say 59 people in 15 states have now been sickened by tainted lettuce. Going to talk about conspiracy theories, PewDiePie, James Inhofe and Jerry Falwell Jr. Tell me about James Inhofe. Who is James Inhofe?
James Inhofe is a Republican who famously, he's recently been charged, or not actually charged, but people found out that as he's a senator in the Senate Armed Services Committee, he's the chairman, and he suggested, or he demanded that Trump dramatically increase defense spending. And then directly after doing that, bought between, or invested between $50,000 and $100,000 in Raytheon, the defense contractor.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, a pretty clear-cut case of something you're not supposed to do. I mean, that's essentially – it's a lot like what Martha Stewart did, except Martha Stewart only heard about insider trading. She didn't demand the president make the situation that creates insider trading.
Right. Right.
And it just seems to me like this is just such an example of the kind of grift that is the real reason Trump exists for Republicans, that the idea that, like – this is what they wanted out of him. They wanted America to be like Russia, where people in power get to just make money off the poor, just get to make money because they're in power, and that's the way things are just stuck.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I the reason I want to get into conspiracies is honestly because it does relate back to it to me, because
clear up who James Mountain Inhofe is. He's the chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, and he only made an investment of a couple thousand dollars. I mean, for somebody who, I'm sure he's a millionaire, this is chump
right,
change.
Between 50 and 100,000, which is about the same amount Martha Stewart went to prison for.
Right. I mean, it's just stupid. But he has canceled the investment, and he blamed his investment advisor. In his defense, he's saying that he didn't do this.
Right. And he immediately, when he was caught, he immediately undid it. But, and look, I'm not going to say for sure that this isn't some very bad coincidence. It just seems to me like we have a country where there's a lot more of people saying, don't pay attention to the very real crimes I'm committing because someone else is doing something ridiculously insane that is not real, but you'll pay attention to that. It's the reason why, you know, millions of people in this country think it's okay that Donald Trump coordinated with Russians to win an election because Hillary Clinton is a pedophile cannibal who only pretends to like hot sauce.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think there's a correlation there. I think the more that they see people, the American people, not paying attention to reality and not believing reality, the more they think they can get away with stuff. And that's why, you know, Trump lies constantly, because it's just a game of they're just going to believe everything. And so in order to still believe in Trump, you have to believe that there is this insanely wild parallel universe that exists where all these other things have to be true also. So that's what I see when I see the Raytheon thing. I see another example of just the Trump effect. It just encourages people to be more thug-like, mm-hmm. more organized crime-like.
Well, it's pretty outrageous how easy it is for lawmakers to trade stocks. This isn't the first time or the last. Because no matter how much they try to get money out of the Senate and the House, they're still allowed legally to pass on inside information to their wife and their kids. They're not allowed to act on insider information, congressmen and senators, but they are allowed to call their son-in-law or their wife and give them inside information. And you
right.
have,
and you're right. I don't want to make it sound as if this isn't already a systemic problem.
Yeah.
That this is constantly happening. I get that. It just seemed like this seemed like they were dropping the pretense,
mm-hmm.
almost. Like with Blagojevich, where it was – this had been done for so long. You know, when Blagojevich was quote-unquote selling Barack Obama's vacant Senate seat, it was so ingrained in politics to get something out of that he forgot it's illegal.
Mm-hmm.
And just started saying it outright. I mean
– well, you know about Spencer Baucus? I don't mean to interrupt you, but Spencer Baucus was a congressman from the state of Alabama. He served on the House Financial Services Committee in 2008. Hank Paulson, Ben Bernanke, came in and said, hey, guess what? There's no money. We need TARP. We need a bailout. The banks are all failing. And Spencer Baucus, and this is perfectly legal, said, really? The banks are failing? Capitalism is about to go under? Hang on for one second. I'll be right back. Excuses himself, gets on the phone, calls his broker, and shorts the stock market. Then comes back into the meeting.
I bet the guys from the movie The Big Short must have been furious because they spent all this time uncovering this massive problem. And this guy was just like, this guy basically had the same exact movie, except it took 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah, that person should be in jail. And it really sucks. It honestly sucks that we live in a country where James Inhofe is not even going to get in trouble. That in a decently run culture, James Inhofe would have – his children would be changing their names and he would lose his pension. But we don't live in that country.
Right.
People in power can get away with almost everything. Now, yeah. If it was proven that, you know, if he actually directed the sale himself, then yeah, it should have been – in a normal society, that would be one of the biggest stories.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Tell me about conspiracy theories. You say that YouTube is trying to clean up the rash.
Well, YouTube is on some level, like, I think that they're putting band-aids on it, but the fact is they're not doing the major work of really excising, because it's such a giant portion of their community. It's like what people were saying was like, it's really weird that if you look up someone like Barack Obama on YouTube, just like that, without having any special search history that they're using for algorithms, if you're a first-time YouTube user and you search Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton, you're going to see absolutely slanderous, in the legal sense of the word, and insane attacks on them in these conspiracy videos, because conspiracies are fun for bored people.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think anyone really acknowledges the danger of it, because it – like I said, I think the more you separate people from reality using conspiracies, the more those people are not going to be vigilant when real bad things happen, because they're not living in reality anymore. And I think like Russia is a perfect example of that, how Russia's lying has become all the more crazy in the last several years, starting with, you know, invading Crimea and pretending that it wasn't happening, that these weren't Russians. This thing we'll talk about in a minute, Boris the Robot. There's a real thing where I think we're damaging people, and I don't.
And what do we do about it? What are you going to do about it?
The only thing we could do about it is to have a culture that absolutely rejected lying like this. I mean, what it brings up the other big story of this week: the National Enquirer. The National Enquirer, we know, was coordinating with the Trump campaign, committing campaign finance violations by shutting down stories that made Trump look bad. But the National Enquirer is the perfect center of this story, because they are the grandfather of all this fake news shit.
I disagree.
Maybe not. Maybe grandfather.
No. Everything you read in the National Enquirer is as true as anything you're going to read in the Washington Post or the New York Times. They were sued into real journalism. They broke the Monica Lewinsky case. They broke Gary Hart. They are salacious, but they get sued a lot, so they're controlled by their lawyers. If it's in the National Enquirer, chances are it's true.
Yeah, well, to be fair, I'm talking about growing up. You know, I've been on this earth for a few decades. I certainly remember what I've seen on the cover of the National Enquirer, and it certainly seemed like we're talking about like an organization that's job was simply to make things up that people would buy.
That's news of the world. No, that's news of the world. National Enquirer got sued by Carol Burnett. I think it got sued by Marty Ingalls. They get sued a lot.
And for lying.
For lying. And they cleaned up their act. They cleaned it up about 25 years ago. They had become a trusted source in news. Now, they were doing the catch and hold. You know, David Pecker was buying up stories and keeping them from the American people to help Donald Trump. That's not a lie. They're not lying. They're withholding. But when they write something, chances are it's true.
No. I'm not saying that what they're in trouble for is directly related back to their history of fake journalism,
Not fake journalism. The family who owns it is probably owned by the Gambinos. But they're not doing like Bat Boy anymore, or UFOs, or guy who can bend spoons with his eyes. Those are other newspapers. National Enquirer is... they proved themselves during the Clinton impeachment that they're doing real journalism.
Having real stories in with fake ones doesn't make you real journalism either. I've had people make that exact point too. You know, sometimes it's not like they're not having people search for real stories and search for, you know, salacious stories. But, you know, look, I don't have at my fingertips how many examples I have of recent National Enquirer stories that they were sued for. But the fact is, Trump has before touted that the National Enquirer is real. Now
they do checkbook journalism. That's what
okay,
they do.
So when
and
they
by
said
checkbook,
Hillary,
but so when
so
they
when
do
they said,
checkbook journalism, what they do is they buy stories from people who know something, and they also buy stories to shut people up as gifts to Trump.
Okay, so when you said so, I'm being. I couldn't, off the top of my head, tell you, you know, what the National Enquirer has said lately. But let me ask you this. So when they had 2 years ago, Hillary Clinton has 6 months to live. Was that real journalism?
They probably bought a
front page.
Yeah, I know. I don't know if it made the National Enquirer. Was it on the National Enquirer?
This is the cover of the National Enquirer. Hillary, 6 months to live, brain cancer, blood clots, MS, strokes, and alcohol abuse.
Yeah, well,
that's what I'm talking about, Dave.
Okay, well, you're probably right in that you can say anything you want about a politician without being sued. A politician cannot sue you for slander or libel. It's very rare. But a celebrity can.
Making stuff up about Hillary Clinton having 6 months to live is all the evidence I need to say that this is a fake organization that puts out fake news just to get
no more than Fox News does, no more than anybody does.
I would say a little more, because even Fox News wasn't going to come out and just say as a fact these are things are happening. Maybe some pundits did.
We've stumbled into the solution. Rush Limbaugh and Sean Hannity can say anything about a politician and they don't have to worry about being sued. But if they say something about a comedian or a model or a writer, you can sue them. And that, I think, has been responsible for the coarsening of our politics, that politicians can be lied about all the time and they have no recourse.
Right. And look, I stand by what I was saying then about the National Enquirer.
Because yeah, you're probably right. You're probably right.
And what I find depressing.
But they're not telling any. They're not lying about. They're not lying about Bobby Brown and Whitney Houston.
Okay, I believe you. I don't read the National Enquirer, but I also don't respect people who do, and I think that's fair. I think people who buy the National Enquirer—that's their newspaper. I think there's something wrong with them. I think that it is a measure of boredom and ignorance, and I think that people's lack of shame about that kind of behavior is why we're in this situation. And when I say this situation, I'm trying, and maybe I'm wrong, I'm trying to draw a parallel between the world of fakeness, the world of false reality, and the world where strong men think they can get away with more. Because, like, the most depressing thing about how lazy, to me, about Putin and lying has been how lazy it is. You know, like, and I think that's part of it. Like, people just believe anything now. And I think that's why we live in a world where Putin was like, what if we just said they're just Russians? They're not Russians. They're just people in Russian costumes. Or like, you know, it's like I read 1984 in college like everyone else. And, you know, it's very educating. You read about like, oh, about how governments want to control your information. But the sad thing is, it's that like it's so much lazier than in the books. Like at least 1984 was complicated. Whereas like if you're just going to destroy reality with lies, at least make it intriguing. Like, Putin acts like a supervillain, but not even like a Dr. Doom young adult supervillain. He's like a backyard wrestler trying to rip off Dr. Doom without getting sued. Like, it's just it's so depressing that like the conspiracies aren't more complex.
So tell me about Boris the Robot. Tell me about Boris the Robot.
Right, this Boris the Robot thing is just such a perfect example. They had this big conference for robotics for, you know, young people in Russia, which is in and of itself a very good idea. Get kids involved in robotics. You know, Russia's always had a very good history with engineers, very smart people. And on the news, the state-run news, they had one of the robots on display, and the robot was dancing, and it was pretty amazing the way it was dancing. But if you watched it for even a second, you'll be like, that's a guy in a suit.
Was he like, doing the robot?
No, unfortunately, he was doing like much worse dancing. But like you could see, you know, you could pretty quickly tell like when it's just a guy in a suit. Mm-hmm. And the sad thing was, it's not like the robotics. It would be such an interesting story if the robotics company or that this conference put together this whole conspiracy where they wanted people to believe that they were much further along in the robotics, you know, race. And they put a man inside a suit that was designed to look like a real robot and defy all these expectations. That would actually at least be interesting. What actually happened was this was just a dick in a costume that no one at the robotics conference even, you know, acknowledged or thought was a real robot, but they just decided to put on the news as if it's a real robot to make the rest of the world think Russia was doing so great with robotics.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, that's what's depressing about it. The lies are so lazy. Like, they don't care about being believable anymore. That's what pisses me off.
Mm-hmm.
At least let me think I'm in some, like, cool movie where, you know, everyone's being watched. Not just that the lazy president is just throwing shit out every 5 seconds because he's bored.
Okay. By the way, the Wall Street Journal is reporting that the committee that ran the inauguration for Donald Trump is being investigated for fraud. Melania's best friend, Stephanie Winston Wolkoff, ran the inauguration committee, and about $107 million can't be accounted for.
Right. And that relates exactly to what we're talking about, this sort of general idea of lazy grifting.
Mm-hmm.
Like, who steal? Like, just back up for a second. It was his first day as president. Who steals from work on your first day? Everyone steals from work. Only a lunatic does it your first freaking day. That's what this was. This was just...
They can't help themselves. They see money.
Second, it's in front of them. They take it.
Right.
Like, absolutely. This was the first thing they did. The first thing he did as president was this inauguration. And he was already like, well, how can we steal from this? Does anybody take a look at the books? Like, his first question was, who oversees the books on this? And they're like, well, no one. You're the president. And he said, oh.
The first thing he had to do legally was set up a transition committee. And he put Chris Christie in charge of the transition committee. This was back during the general election, probably in September. Christie raised, I don't know, let's say $25 million, and Trump blew up. And he said, you're stealing money from me. And Chris Christie said, you put me in charge of the transition committee. By federal law, I have to set up the committee and start vetting people in case you win this election. And it costs money, and people have donated to this committee. And Donald Trump blew up. He said, you're stealing money from me. That's my money. So they had to shut down the fundraising for the transition committee, which is why so many posts, I think he gets to name 5,000 people in the executive branch. I think like a third of it is filled because they didn't have any money to spend on the transition.
And that's because Trump's attitude, of course, he thinks everyone's like him. He thinks everyone breaks rules for emotional reasons and steals. So he can't imagine. That's why he's so angry about the just concept that there's anyone in Washington who has a regular job that isn't partisan. He can't even wrap his head around it, of someone just doing their job.
He's never done anything other than for himself.
Right. Everything to him is transactional. So that's why, like with James Comey, he immediately, why would Comey tell me that there's something after me unless what does he want?
Mm-hmm. What's his game?
And it's sort of just the toxicity of him as a man and how it gets into everything else, because it's just like, you know, a guy who cheats on his wife constantly thinks he's being cheated on because he can't imagine someone who just loves their spouse.
Exactly. And it does permeate itself into our lifestyle. So many people cut corners. So many people cheat because the fish rots from the head down. And it's been going on since Reagan. These laws are not enforceable. It's selective. It's prosecutorial discretion. So
we don't have respect for law and order in this country. A big part of that is because law and order let us down. That's obviously a big part of it. The police need to be reprogrammed, honestly, in general. I think there's a lot of good cops out there, but there's a systemic problem in law enforcement. And I like to believe that if things were done right, people would have the kind of respect that some people think they already deserve outright. You know what I mean?
But we have 2.3 million people behind bars, so obviously we do enforce some laws. You just have to be black or Hispanic.
Yeah, exactly. We enforce laws against poor people. is essentially the country we live in. And, you know, it's very pie in the sky, but I do believe that law and order is much more important than the average person seems to say about it, but because it has to earn it, it has to deserve it. And it's really sad how Trump has used completely unrelated legal inequities to say that's why he should be allowed to get away with being a billionaire grifter who is stealing from our country and stealing from our future.
Well, you grew up in New York City, right?
Jersey and Brooklyn, yeah.
And you know what the law is in New York City. It's not for the rich. If you're a real estate developer, you build. You get that thing built. You make deals with the mafia. You cut corners. You cut costs. They're not going to tear your building down once it's built. And that's how Trump thinks. Just get it up. Get that thing up no matter what. We'll pay people off along the way and after.
Yeah.
And that's what his presidency is. He said after the midterms, I'll figure something out. I always do.
He doesn't like to work hard. We know that. He likes to wing it because he's lazy. And but he's also a narcissist, so he needs to say that's not what he's doing. That's why in that actually interview he did today, he made some weird rambling reference to how some people work hard, I work smart, which is essentially the lazy man's anthem. That's just something people say when they don't work hard.
Or you get other people to do it for you and take the credit. What'd you think of the meeting with Pelosi?
Oh, I thought it was really interesting that Trump thought it would play well for him for this to be public. I think that he really doesn't understand how childish he comes across, especially for someone who's so obsessed with body language. I would have thought he would be better about that because, dude, you just got dunked on by a tiny old woman in the eyes of, like, your fans.
You all saw it wrong. You did not see the same confrontation that I saw. I thought he steamrolled over Pelosi and Schumer. I thought he came across great. She was weak. She stands for nothing. She was inarticulate. He owned the government shutdown, which was brilliant. They got to do better than Pelosi and Schumer.
Well, Pelosi and Schumer aren't who we're resting our future on exactly.
Yes, we are. We're all rooting for them. I know too many people who said, oh, wasn't Nancy great the way she stood up? I said, you know, you're rooting for Nancy the same way you root for your five-year-old when she's playing soccer. This is hardball, and we need somebody who is strong and believes in something. Nancy was, that was a pathetic display of cowardice on her part.
I mean,
and Schumer's.
Well, are you saying the content of what they said back or the way they said it? Because I don't really care about how they say anything. This is just, I'm talking about quotes here. I'm talking about like the fact that all he can say when, you know, he says something untrue is, oh, well, you know, they hate, whoever said that hates me.
Yeah.
Look, this is the process. Now he has to deal with people who aren't going to roll over for him, who aren't terrified of him.
Well, it sure looked like they were rolling over for him during that White House meeting that the press got to see.
No, they got him to say that the government shutdown is completely his fault.
And you know what? He said
they got him to acknowledge.
And he came across fantastic. He said, fine, I own it.
Really?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Exactly. He's saying I own it like a five-year-old who says, fine, I wanted it broken. This is they got him to be the entirety of the reason it gets shut down for his little wall. And now everything he says gets to, you know, everyone who wants to attack him gets to fact check it and show how many ways he wasn't telling the truth. Look,
that doesn't matter whether or not he's,
if you're looking
the
at
truth.
It for body language, sure. But even then, I thought he looked weak. I'm not saying Pelosi
he's trying
looked
to,
great.
He's
I'm
trying
he
to. This is how you have to fight Trump. He's trying to shock the system. A government shutdown serves his needs because it's one surprise after another. It's so the other side is constantly doing stutter steps and is confused. That's what he wants to do. He loves a government shutdown because that becomes the next thing to talk about. And while we're talking about a government shutdown, he's getting exactly what he wants. Smaller government, and Zinke and DeVos and all the other people in the cabinet can, you know, rob us blind. Unless the Democrats come up with a unifying theory about what they want, they're not going to be able to stand up to him. And they proved it during that Oval Office meeting because she couldn't even call him a liar.
Well, Schumer did. And Schumer was very clear. He says, you talk about your $5 billion, which gets four Pinocchios on and fact checkers.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, well, that's Washington Post. Yeah, good comeback, Trump. That really changes everything.
I'm telling you, this is not how you fight Trump. He is a fascist, and he's going to steamroll over our side unless we stand for something and offer an alternative, which Pelosi and Schumer don't. They believe
this was not about their agenda.
What
this
do they
was
believe
about the
in?
Wall.
What, yeah, what, so he wants something. So he can say, build my wall, build my wall, build my wall. And all Pelosi and Schumer get to say is no. They don't believe in anything. Why aren't they talking about Medicare for all?
Well, I'm not saying they shouldn't be talking about that, but I'm saying when the argument is about the president wants this and it's their job to stop it, I thought that they did an adequate job of
their job is to have an idea.
The wall is your dick. That's what she said.
Ah, that's so immature and childish to question his manhood.
To him, it is. But that's what he's doing.
You know what it means? It means the Democratic Party has no ideas and they don't stand for anything. You say the wall, I say Medicare for all.
Well, look, Democratic Party is not just the most moderate leaders of it. They were there to
They don't stand for anything. They don't stand for anything.
Yeah, and I do want us to have Medicare for all. And I do want them
There is nothing more important than universal health insurance. And for Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer to go to the Oval Office and not say that, he can pick the wall. He can talk about border security. And they can't say, you want to talk about making people secure? Look what the health insurance lobbyists are doing. Look at the 50,000 people who die every year because they're underinsured. You want to talk about security? I'm more frightened of Aetna and United Healthcare than I am of that caravan, Mr. Trump. That's what Nancy Pelosi has to say. But they don't believe that.
And they could have talked about that instead of the wall. They could have talked about, I can't believe we're talking about border security at all when you still have all those children in cages. There's a lot of things that
the American people don't care about the children in cages. They don't care about the caravan. They care about living. And Trump has tapped into that. He's telling lies, but he's saying that there are people on the border, terrorists are coming to get you. And unless the Democrats pick up on that and say, you know what? There's a real bogeyman out there, and it's the health insurance companies. They're not going to be able to combat Trump and his lies because they don't believe in anything. Pelosi and Schumer, at best, are incrementalists. And Martin Luther King said incrementalism is a sin. And that's exactly how fascists roll over you. If you don't believe in anything and you're calling for moderation and you're wringing your hands and you're trying to be reasonable and we're the adult in the room and I'm the mommy, that gets you nowhere. Not in this country. Not in this country. Very quickly, tell me about PewDiePie.
PewDiePie, he, of course, we've talked about him before. He's the most popular man on YouTube, and he's a beautiful Nordic boy who reacts and smiles and claps at things on the internet. And he's extremely popular, and he has been criticized before for making anti-Semitic jokes or supporting anti-Semitic other channels, and recently did it again where he told people to check out ER, which is a not even that popular YouTube channel that mostly, like a lot of neo-Nazi-related channels, loves anime for some reason. But he's a guy who does have a lot of videos that are clearly white supremacist, anti-Jewish. And PewDiePie said, oh, this is just a mistake. Everyone's always trying to call me a Nazi. I just saw one of his videos and liked it. Of course, the one video that he saw did a joke about Heather Heyer's murder at the Charlottesville riots.
Right. He has a long history of racist KKK anti-Semitic. And what country is he from?
Sweden. It is Sweden. Yeah.
Okay.
He's really popular. But the thing is, he's doing this thing that a lot of these like people who have loose associations with, you know, white supremacy do, where it's a joke. It's okay. It's just a joke. I'm going to say something I 100% believe, but smirk and pretend I'm joking.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy, ER, is just another unfunny just YouTube guy who thinks that, you know, he's also been taken out of context. But you look at what he's saying, and it's very clearly from a place of support for fascists and hatred of anarchists and communists, which is, you know, a very common thing among neo-Nazis lately, among white supremacists. And I even saw a quote of his from a questionnaire they gave to this guy ER that really shows you exactly all you need to know about the person. Someone said, what's the best way to red pill people on the Jewish question? Now, red pill is a matrix reference that refers to the idea of seeing, quote, the truth, meaning the truth from the eyes of, like, misogynist, men's rights, racist.
Mm-hmm.
And the ER guy said in the question, how to red people on the Jewish question, was pretend to joke about it until the punchline actually lands.
That's what Ann Coulter and Rush Limbaugh do.
Exactly.
And Milo.
And they're all doing the same thing. And by the way, PewDiePie keeps saying he's not politically affiliated with the right at all. But then you see he calls out, he's a fan of people like Ben Shapiro and a lot of other people that are very much on the Proud Boys side of politics. I think he's a Jordan Peterson guy even. And it seems like he's doing this, and he is known for making a lot of Nazi jokes and Jewish jokes. And it's like, I'm a Jew. You're a Jew. We make Holocaust jokes. Don't you have to be on the anti-Holocaust side of it to make the jokes?
Yeah.
Like, don't you? That's sort of the whole point. I can make this joke because you know I don't actually believe in it.
Yeah, but I'm not doing that. I don't make those jokes anymore.
I know. I'm not necessarily making them either. But I think I have, and I think we know what we're talking about. And I've heard you make jokes, you know, there were gallows humor kind of jokes. There's this weird thing where, like, they think it's okay to make jokes when they're not joking. Like, they can just say something they believe in the cadence of a joke, and that's enough to get away. Yeah. Away with it. And that goes back to the stupidity and the laziness of the lies now.
Yeah.
And yeah, PewDiePie sucks. And it goes along with the whole YouTube problem. YouTube is a place where it is very, very popular to say crazy lies. And people like it because when you're bored and stupid, you like tabloids. It's interesting because it's like, oh my God, what a crazy world I'm living in when these things are true. And like PewDiePie, the saddest thing about it is that, like, this guy's really popular, but he's popular with like 14-year-olds. His fans are all
kids. Well, he plays video games. That's all he does.
He does mostly video games, but he just talks, and it's really weird that these people are so devoted to someone so innocuous in how he's entertaining people. Like, you know that they hacked into all these printers to demand that people become fans of his.
Mm-hmm.
That was the thing his fans did. That's weird behavior. It's very weird. And that, because I think a lot of these children, he has millions and millions of fans. And I think that for a lot of these kids, morality is what PewDiePie says it is.
Right.
As horrible a sentence as I just said, how many people are going to fall into this neo-Nazi mentality because PewDiePie is normalizing it. He's normalizing that kind of half-kidding white nationalist language, and he's normalizing these very – like people that are always – nothing's quote-unquote serious. But it's like when you said – it's like what you said to Aaron Berg after the White Guys Matter thing about how pretending to be stupid can be really, really dangerous when stupid gets into power.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's exactly what this is.
Yeah. Dave Sirus, what is the name of Blame Storming? What is the name of your podcast named Blame Storming?
That's it.
I know. Where do people find it?
You know, you look it up. You can check me out also. Follow my Instagram, Dave Sirus, or Twitter.
Great.
They're both Dave, Sirus. And hey, this Sunday at 9:30, come to Lucky Jack's downtown and watch me roast battle again.
Great. Dave Sirus, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Stand line for 1 second.
If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love.
Let's go to the Upper West Side where Kevin Bartini is standing by. It's been a while. We'll tell you why it's been a while in a second. Kevin Bartini has two comedy CDs that have been re-released, the Unintentionally White album and Showing the Horses Who's Boss. Go to Amazon, iTunes, go to kevinbartini.com. Buy those for Christmas if you want to laugh. Hello there, Kevin Bartini.
Well, hello there, David Feldman. How are you today?
Well, I'm a little concerned because Christmas Eve is coming up, and it's the most dangerous time of the year.
It is. It is the most dangerous time of the year.
It's the most dangerous time of the year. Why is it the most dangerous time of the year?
Statistically, you are most likely to get a heart attack on Christmas Eve more than any other day of the year. And specifically at nighttime around 10 p.m., you are most likely to suffer a heart attack. And that is according to a British study over the last decade or so of they timed out on a chart every heart attack.
You know why?
Why the Christmas?
Yeah.
I think a number of factors.
I think it's you check your credit card bill.
Yeah, you do it that night. That's probably a bad idea. Probably kind of for a few days. It's the stress. It's family. It's travel. It's then more alcohol and more food and all that other crap on top of it that it does cause heart attacks on Christmas Eve. Which is a bummer, but it is also a good way to get the people out of your house around 10 p.m. my family, my parents host the whole family Christmas Eve, and they like to stay late. And then we have my niece and nephew who are about, 5 and 8 years old, and they like to get up at the crack of fuck to see what Santa brought. So odds are my chances of dying by falling asleep behind the wheel would come around 3 p.m. Christmas afternoon as I'm hightailing it back to New York City on about 1 hour's rest and a belly full of nog. It's awful.
People smell bad this time of year. They reek of cheese.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Stale booze and cigarettes. Everybody smokes. Everybody who doesn't smoke starts smoking again, at least cigars.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it has to do with all the stress. It's easy to get back into old habits and such. And yeah, people stink. People are gross. And you still got to buy them shit. It's like an end of the year tax is what Christmas is. It really is. It's like you've been in my life all year. All right, now I need, now you need to pay the piper here for all the fun times we've had. And God forbid that you should spend less on your tax than I spend on my tax towards you. I mean, how many times, that's what I do on my New Year's Eve is I go through my checklist of people from the last year. It's basically like Facebook unfriending in real life. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, this guy was a douche. This guy was cool. This guy put up that one post for Trump. He's gone. This fucker only got me a mug at Christmas.
Hey, by the way.
Yeah.
Is this an Italian curse? Because I saw you do this on Twitter and I went, wow. Somebody insulted you. I think somebody didn't like an appearance that you did on my show. And do you remember what you wrote back? This is the worst curse that I've ever heard in my life.
I don't know exactly what you're saying, but I did come up with one that at one time I thought was the worst thing you could say to somebody. And I'm guessing that it's, I hope you outlive your children. Is that the one?
I saw it. I saved it because it was just so horrible.
Yeah.
And it's sweet at the same time.
And it cuts right to the bone. You're really, it's a clean way of saying, I hope your kids die. I mean, it's up.
Now I'm in the Christmas spirit.
Now
you got me.
But just to show people that either I'm not all bad or I'm bipolar, I also came up with the world's greatest toast, and that's when I say, I hope that the tree they cut down to make your to create your casket hasn't been planted yet.
Oh, that's sweet.
That's really nice, right? That means I hope you have to live like another century. So I do it on either way. I can hit you with a nice little bit of poetry.
This would be a good exercise for you to do each week.
Sure.
To come up with various toasts that we can offer up. So what was the best Christmas you ever had? And do you measure it by gifts or the people you're surrounded by?
I don't. Well, I guess you should measure it by the people you're surrounded by, but I judge the people I'm surrounded by the gifts they give.
What's the best gift you ever got?
I don't know. I honestly don't. I guess when I was a kid, when we got our Nintendo, that was pretty awesome. I mean, that's memorable, but I don't know. And it's not that I'm ungrateful. I don't know. It's like stand up for me. I can't think of a particular set. They all just bleed into some sort of a gray in my memory.
And what do you want? What would you like to wake up and see underneath the tree?
Christmas morning?
Yeah. What would you like to see Christmas morning?
I would like to see a clock that says it's 4 p.m.
You want to be able to sleep in.
Yeah, I want to sleep in. No, I don't know. Much to my mother's chagrin, I don't like asking for gifts and stuff like that.
What is a reasonable thing? Because I'm being totally honest with you.
Okay. Yeah.
It's impossible to shop for me because
yes.
What I want is the New York Post for my I want a newspaper.
Like a subscription, you're saying?
No,
I want to go out and get the paper this morning.
No, I want to buy the New York Post. That's what I want. So anything that's not that is not good.
Well,
I don't want clothes.
Yeah.
You buy me a car, then I start thinking about, I got to pay for insurance. I got to pay for the upkeep. I don't want that.
And then that means whoever bought you that car is going to expect a ride at some point for you. Then you're going to have to sever that friendship in a hurry. Uh-huh. So you don't want that. I don't know. Because the thing is, here's the thing that really annoys my mother about me around the holidays is that starting in October, she'll get annoyed at me if I buy myself something, mm-hmm. right? If I go out, buy a jacket or I buy myself a book or something, she's like, well, that could have been something I could have gotten you for Christmas. That could have been on your. And my attitude is, I'm a grown adult. I want this shirt right now. Why do I have to wait 3 months to get it? So no. So I'll just keep buying myself shit. So I'm terrible to get for. Mm-hmm. So I'm never in need. I go and get for myself. But I would think that if there was something big like that, like your own newspaper or something to get.
Hey, do you remember Johnny Carson used to read Letters to Santa and how beautiful it was? Because I want to do a show? Huh?
It's a bit on his show?
Yeah, and I wanted like Conan or somebody to do this.
Yeah.
I think we may have done it on Pepitone Tonight. We used to have this fake talk show years ago on this podcast. I think maybe Eddie might have done this as part of Pepitone Tonight, where you read the letters that were actually written to Santa.
Yeah. Oh, so, and they're just fucked up things kids asked for or wrote in their letters?
Well,
was that the bit? I don't remember Carson
used to read actual letters to Santa.
Right.
And you would cry. You could not get through it because they were so selfless. And
So he was being earnest. It was like the spirit of Christmas. He wasn't trying to do that.
Yeah, and if you go look it up, they were really sweet and sad. Yeah. And he was raising money for something. I don't know what it was.
And I remember that one kid who wrote in, I remember that, asking for a cure for emphysema. Never came through.
For Johnny.
Never came through for Johnny.
Jesus. You are a bad, bad man. You're a bad man. But I always thought it'd be funny to read the letters and then crap on the kid. Anyway, so don't have a heart attack Christmas Eve.
Don't have a heart attack Christmas Eve. But there are ways to get around having a heart attack, and one of them is a diet that's low in fat, and there are now we're finding ways of getting fat out of your diet or helping you to actually eat fatty foods and not digest them and just pass them through. But you have to be willing to eat dirt, literal dirt.
Really?
They think maybe the cure for obesity. And it's apparently something that's gone back to the dawn of man. Like when the cavemen had a bellyache, they would eat dirt. And I guess like the theory is that like, especially like a clay, like a very, you know, like clay, people would eat it. And first of all, your body can't digest it, but it will absorb the other fat around it and keep. So, you know,
the
you
minerals
big steak. Yeah, it's mineral rich. Plus, the fat gloms on to is almost digested by the clay, and then you pass mud, you know. And they think this may be a cure for obesity.
So
you'd be willing to eat a plate of dirt once a week if it meant you would drop 20 pounds a year.
Well, I'll eat it. Filet, their food is pretty disgusting and dirty.
Yeah,
I know there's dirt in Filet.
Of course. Oh, there's an acceptable. I'm sure there is an acceptable amount of dirt that the FDA has approved for any food and anything. You know, there's rat hair and all that other shit in peanut butter. So why wouldn't there be dirt?
So dirt eaters. Yeah.
Who are? You know what? They're just going to look down on the vegetarians the way the vegetarians look down on the meat eaters. They're going to be like, oh, you eat from above the ground. You're eat leaves from trees. Do you know that the tree can feel when you pluck it? The dirt can't feel when you put a trowel into it and take a scoop. Eat a big handful of dirt, and you know what happens when I poop it out the next day? It's dirt all over again. Have you ever pooped a tree? Broccoli is murder.
So eating dirt, I don't think Republicans should hear about this.
About eating dirt? Oh, no, because that'll be the new school lunch program and yeah. What we're feeding the kids in the cages at the border and shit like that. Get away with it even cheaper. They're going for it. Absolutely.
Well, you fly for the holidays, don't you? Or you're driving to visit your parents?
Oh, no. I drive to visit. My parents are only 2.5 hours away. And my wife is in Nebraska, and she's already gone out earlier this month to do her family holiday stuff to avoid the holiday flights.
Well, if you're flying Christmas Eve,
uh-huh.
That's, as we've learned, when most people have a heart attack.
Yes.
If you fly Southwest,
yes,
you can get a new heart.
Yeah, or not, almost. So I read this in the paper. A Southwest flight ended up being diverted mid-flight and brought back to, I believe, to where it took off from was Seattle. And the reason was that they had loaded a heart for a transplant onto the plane, and it was supposed to be delivered to a patient and in Seattle, and they forgot to take it off the plane. And there's the flaw in the system right there is when you know, because you can do a heart transplant, they take it out of someone maybe in, you know, on the other coast and pack it on the dry ice or whatever and get it out to you in a couple of hours. Time's a waste in there, and they just put it on Southwest cargo. I mean, why would you entrust a human heart to Southwest cargo? I mean, Amazon Prime, that's the way to go. You want to get something there the next day or same day. Go Amazon Prime same day and just have that shit sent out. What I would do is if it was a heart of a loved one, I would go on Amazon Prime and I would purchase something like a defibrillator or something that the person can use also, or a new cookbook on eating healthy. And I would have that sent same day and then have the heart added right in there and two birds, one stone. What do you think?
But I didn't know that a heart can stay useful after it's just been sitting around flying on us.
It's the living tissue and the organ does not necessarily shut down. You know, they transport organs, heart, liver, things all over the country, all over the, you know, it's a common thing on a, you know, like they used to do that on about every other episode of ER, It's like there was a big countdown where they had to get to the wait for the chopper to land on the hospital airport because some heart was sent in. And wasn't that even a plot point in Airplane years ago? I'm pretty sure.
And where do they put it? Like the overhead rack? Where does it go?
It's well, if you're ever on a flight and you're in first class and they don't have champagne, it's because they had to keep the fridge empty. And you'll know there's a human heart there. Now, here's the thing, David. If you were on that flight and all of a sudden your flight is diverted and then they tell you that the reason is there's a human heart and it has, you know, time's a waste, is a waste, and we have to turn around to save this life. And then you'd be like, oh, okay, I get it. Fine. I'll, you know, 5 hours. But then how pissed would you be like the next day to find out like that heart was going to Dick Cheney? Then I would sue the airline.
Yeah. For him to eat. Not even to put it.
Just for him to eat.
Hey, before you go, Viagra was originally for your heart.
Yes, yes, originally for your heart.
Yeah.
Not your penis, yes. And then as a happy accident, they found out.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, and people took to it.
Yeah.
They seem to enjoy it. But now, just like everything else, people are trying to find new ways of ingesting, you know, they're pills. Like, you don't want to swallow a pill. So, like, you know, if you're the president and the pill's Adderall, you crush it up and snort it. And if you're also like anybody the president's age, you do it with Viagra. But instead of snorting it, now they're putting it into vaporizers and basically smoking it like an e-cigarette. And there is what I read in the news today. People are there's two products out that you can buy on the internet, and it's like you're vaping, and it's Viagra. You're vaping Viagra, and I mean I've thought about this, and I did actually buy one of these vape pens for the Viagra, and it's. I did, because I'm curious, and I knew I was coming on the show, and I want to be able to share this. Mm-hmm. I found it very difficult to make my penis inhale the vapor. It's so much easier to pop a pill, you know, to just...
Yeah. Well, do they have a pill form for Viagra?
A pill form for Viagra?
Can you take a pill of Viagra, or do you have to vape it? Yeah. Oh, okay.
Well, I think they're going to come back around to the pill form. You would have to vape it, and apparently it may be dangerous.
I thought you were going to say you vaped Viagra and found it hard to breathe. Kevin Bartini.
Yes.
Go to his website, kevinbartini.com. He's got two CDs that have been reissued. I cannot recommend a stocking stuffer funnier than this.
Thank you.
Yeah. Go buy Showing the Horses Who's Boss or the Unintentionally White album, or buy both on Amazon and iTunes. Go to kevinbartini.com. Will you stay on the line, sir?
Of course, sir. I will be happy to. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for doing this. If you're enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out. Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Zack Ford is standing by. He is the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. Now, we had a very sweet letter, and I said LGBTQ.
You did. Yeah. That is my title.
And is there a problem with the Q?
I don't think there is, but as you said, we got a very lovely email from a listener who I believe is a college professor, and she got an interesting response from one of her students related to the question you just asked me about the Q, and shared it with us and asked me what my thoughts were. I did send her a long email back, but I didn't show you because I thought it'd be great if we could maybe, you know, kind of have that little conversation on the air for her to hear out, too.
Yeah, great.
Do you want to just kind of read through a little bit of what she shared?
Well, she says that she has a child who is a transgender person and loves you. And I believe she said that if you're not if you're not on the David Feldman show, she doesn't bother to listen.
She did say that, yes.
Yeah.
I wasn't going to bring that up.
I think that's what I remember the most. I also, I don't have the letter in front of me, but she talked about the use of the word queer and how some people perceive that as pejorative. And I was surprised the way you have used it all the time. You're kind of owning the word queer. And LGBTQ, the people who came up with LGBTQ, have decided that queer is a pejorative that they're going to own. Is that a fair statement?
Well, so it's an interesting question about the word queer. And, you know, I think Progress is not just my title, but we've adopted it as our standard acronym for covering the issues related to this community. When I first started there, it was just LGBT. But at one point, we realized that it really made sense to expand it. And there are a couple of reasons why. It's true that the word queer has, for the large part, been reclaimed by our community. And that doesn't mean that it can't still be used as an attack, but it does mean that it's actually found a lot of affirming uses as well. In particular, young people have really adopted the word as a great way to signal that they're exploring either aspects of their sexual orientation or aspects of their gender identity and how they're expressing their gender without narrowing themselves down, right?
Yeah, there's a vagueness. There's something vague about being queer.
Exactly, exactly. And sort of simultaneous with that, the term has become a great umbrella word for every member of the community who is not heterosexual and is not cisgender. So, you know, it's really great to have a word like that because acronym is a word jumble, and even I have tripped over it on occasion, though I've gotten a lot better than most people. So, you know, it's nice to have a term that just says, hey, we're all experiencing this kind of separation from, you know, the norms of society that, you know, for the most part, what homophobia and transphobia look like has a lot in common. Our identities are expressed in a really different way, but we're kind of being policed for our gender in very similar ways. And I think that's why we ever added the T to the acronym and really recognize that trans people are part of the coalition of people sort of fighting for this community. And so adding the Q is sort of a recognition that, you know, we do have these discrete categories, but as progress has moved forward, we've really found a way to recognize how to work together to challenge these, you know, challenge the patriarchy is really mm-hmm. what it is. And so I think that's really important. Now, I'm 33 and I know a lot of older gay men who refuse to use it. They only ever hear it as a slur. They don't want to be identified by it. Nothing. And they're sort of incorrigible in that regard. So I totally appreciate that it's not everyone's cup of tea. But, you know, if you think about it, Queer Eye, the TV show, the original one, Queer Eye for the Straight Guy, right? That was, you know, what, late 90s, early 2000s when that first aired? And it kind of was just okay. No one really batted an eye. The podcast that I used to have actually was called Queer and Queerer. My podcast partner and I just really leaned into that.
When was Q added to LGBT?
So it's the kind of thing that's adapted gradually, and some people have embraced it and some haven't. You know, what's interesting about
it seems to me, but we'll get to that in a second, but it seems to me Queer Eye for the Straight Guy predates the Q being added to LGBT. Is that fair?
Oh, for sure. I mean, when that was used, it wasn't mainstream by any means, but I think it was sort of the first indication that, like, hey, you know, this word, something else is happening to this word. And the one other thing I want to point out is that the distinction I always offer people is that we only really use it as an adjective in our reclamation. So I identify as queer. I am a member of the queer community. I try to advocate for the rights of queer people. You know, we have queer studies in academia, but we don't use it as a noun. You know, I am not a queer. And if you called me a queer, that would be an insult. That would be very derogatory. And, you know, it's actually a similar rule to what we follow for transgender, which is transgender is an adjective. And you don't call a person a transgender or look at those transgenders. That's very wrong, not language anybody should be using. And so it's the similar rule for queer. And I think that that's sort of, we've drawn this line, we recognize how it can be used in a way to attack us, but we found ways to use that don't.
I see. That's interesting. But before we get to the letter you wrote, or did you basically just relate what you wrote?
I'm sharing a lot of what I wrote. There's a couple other things we can talk about.
I want to ask you about Mika Brzezinski, if you don't mind.
Sure. Oh, butt boy was her term of endearment this week, wasn't it?
She was doing a tirade against Mike Pompeo and Donald Trump, and Mike Pompeo is now our Secretary of State, and I guess he's a little too close to the Saudi Arabians, and Mika was attacking him, and she said, when you're not too busy being Donald Trump's butt boy, maybe you can stand up for something that's right. And she wasn't on Morning Joe Thursday. And some people think it's because she's being disciplined for using the term butt boy. She most definitely did not use it as a homosexual slur. She did it to attack Mike Pompeo. Does she get a pass for that? How bad is that?
So it's bad, and we can talk about why. From my understanding, she has apologized. So I don't know if we'll see her back on the air Friday morning or not. You know, this speaks to an issue that's actually come up a lot with a lot of mainstream and LGBTQ affirming comedians when they've, you know, portrayed Trump and Putin as a gay relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of them is the other's butt boy, for lack of a different word that I might say on your show. And that's problematic, too, because what it suggests is that a gay man that is allowing himself to be penetrated by another man is weak. You know, this is something that varies from culture to culture, but I hear a lot about from Central American and Mexican cultural norms, where there's this concept of machismo, and you actually see homophobia manifest a little bit differently, where gay men who, you know, are essentially tops are not necessarily considered taboo, but gay men who are bottoms, and whether or not you know what kind of sex they're actually having, you think of the more effeminate presenting kind of gay man, they are subjected to more homophobia because they don't possess the same kind of machismo. And so that's really the same, you know, underlying context when you're making this joke. The punchline of the joke is, oh, since he's letting another guy screw him, he's weak. And so it does have this underlying homophobia to it, even if that's not what your intention is in communicating it.
I see. I see. So in the gay community, I would assume that there are some guys who are just tops and they can't bring themselves to be bottoms. And I would assume those tops are closeted Republicans.
Well, I don't think it's that simple, but also there's just a whole lot of, you know, problem about classifying people just as tops or bottoms either. And like, I don't want to suggest that like there's an easy answer to this, because it is a thing that we do. Like on my Grindr profile right now, it indicates, you know, my preferences in terms of that. And, you know, there are a lot of reasons for it. Some people don't get as much pleasure from one or the other. Bottoming is also, for a lot of gay men, they take it seriously in terms of how much they prepare themselves to be clean, to, you know, like using enemas and things like that. And so some people just don't want to go to that work. It's not worth what they get out of it for them. And the reality is that we can all enjoy all of it. And the automatic sorting we do, unfortunately, reinforces some right. of those same stereotypes that go with it in terms of personalities and things like that. So, you know, it's this weird thing where we joke about it, but in some cases, we're actually part of the same problem that we're challenging others about.
I see. I don't worry about Mika Brzezinski. I think it was more out of ignorance, and she's a font of that, than wanting to hurt anybody in the gay community, right?
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I accept her apology. There are some other comedians who have done a lot of that Trump Putin stuff that haven't really apologized or sort of recognized that those portrayals are reinforcing some negative stereotypes people have might have about us.
I used to do jokes about Ann Coulter being a man. Somebody wrote to me and said, that's offensive to the transgender community. I got pissed off, you know, and then this person showed me some pictures of transgender people getting, you know, what happens to them sometimes when they get beaten up. And I said, that's it. I get it.
You know, this is just a little tangent thought that goes with it. But last week I went to an event where Judy and Dennis Shepherd spoke. Hmm. And, you know, it's been 20 years since Matthew Shepherd was killed. And so, there, you know, he was just interned at the National Cathedral, and they're doing a lot of new kind of press outreach to recognize the anniversary of his passing. And of course, next year is Stonewall, too. So there's a lot of LGBTQ history stuff that's sort of circling about. But at the presentation, one of the audience members asked a question about, you know, why is it that Matt's death 20 years ago, you know, when he was tied to that fence, got such national visibility, and we've just had the 24th transgender murder of the year this past week, mostly trans women of color, and there's no national attention really paid to it at all. It's not that these, maybe they're not quite as brutal as Matthew's death on the fence, but they're still being murdered. They're being shot to death and killed in other violent ways. And, you know, we're lucky if the police and news reports about them even correctly name and identify their gender, let alone whether it gets any attention at all, whether it even is noticed by the groups that are actively trying to find and document these cases across the country. And Judy took the question and she said, I don't know. I have no idea why Matt's death stood out and so many other people's, you know, experiences of violence and discrimination do not. And she only wished she knew what she could do to help bring that light to all of these other things that we're still dealing with and sort of get away from the idea that, like, suddenly we've moved past it.
By the way, the news cycles come so fast and furious, we haven't even talked about Kevin Hart and his tweets that were pretty bad. And Michael Che, who does Weekend Updates, said, I couldn't believe he said that. He said something to the effect, if you go through everybody's tweets, you're never going to allow a black comic to host the Oscars. And he spoke of the homophobia in the black community, which I thought was kind of reckless on his part, especially since we've talked about Proposition 8 in California. and how we were led to believe that it was the black churches that was responsible for getting the vote out on Proposition 8, which was a gay rights bill in California about 8 years ago, right?
Prop 8 was a ban on same-sex marriage.
A ban on, yeah, same-sex marriage.
Yeah.
And we were led to believe it was the black churches. I think you told us, or somebody told us, that it was the Mormons. It had nothing to do with the black churches.
Right. Well, I mean, there was even a headline on in some magazine, I think it was The Advocate, like, is black is the new gay, or something like that, that, like, really pinned it all on African-American communities. And really, this myth of homophobia among the African-American community and among black churches is something that our opponents have actually tried to use a lot. The National Organization for Marriage had this memo leak. This was back in like 2011, 2012, that specifically said our whole goal is to drive a wedge between the gay and black communities by framing the gay rights as somehow trying to, you know, appropriate the gains of the civil rights movement and really tap into this idea that black people will think that gay people don't deserve civil rights because they're stepping on the fights that they previously fought. And so we, you know, all magnified this once it leaked and really called out this tactic. But the reality is that it doesn't actually look that way. And when we look at this recent polling on questions like, you know, should the Christian baker get to refuse service to the gay customer, it's actually people of color who have the strongest responses saying, no, they should not be allowed to discriminate, that actually really have our backs on that. So it's this myth that has really perpetuated, and I'm not going to say that being black and gay is the same as being white and gay, because there are definitely different issues with the intersection of that. And just as I was talking about the concept of machismo with Latino Americans, Latinx Americans, there is certainly some different issues of how masculinity presents itself in the black community. And certainly I'm not an expert on that, so I'm not going to, you know, try to pretend I know more about how that looks. But it's just a myth. And personally, I think Michael Che is reckless about a lot of the commentary that he tries to offer. Mm-hmm. He strikes me, every magazine I feel like has some writer whose job it is to find the viewpoint that will get people chattering about it. And it's not necessarily a good viewpoint. It's just the one that no one else has thought of or no one else has thought to say. And Michael Che, I feel like, cares more about getting attention for taking weird positions than he does actually think about the quality of those positions.
And so, Dave Chappelle had some choice words about the transgender community. He did a routine about transgender people, compared the plight of African Americans to transgender people. He's probably the best comedian out there, but
I think he was the best comedian out there.
He sure missed the mark there.
Well, I think it's symbolic of like what's happened to his career, that like not only did he do it once, he's done it many times, and he's talked about how he's gotten feedback for it and how he doesn't care and he keeps doing it. So, you know, I used to really respect Dave Chappelle. I thought he was a really smart comedian. I thought he did a lot of great things on his show. But if he's going to be so self-important that he cares more about whether or not he's allowed to be transphobic than actually thinking of some thoughtful material to put out there, you know, I think it speaks to why, you know, his comedy career does not have nearly the same luster that it once did.
Well, I also think there's a problem in America. We listen to comedians too much. They've become the new intellectuals. The problem with that is so much of their thought is shaped by comedy clubs. And comedy club audiences aren't the brightest. So there's some bright, smart comedians out there, but they're not as smart as professors or journalists or writers, for the most part, because they're constrained by needing to shock and get a laugh.
Perhaps, but I sometimes think comedians are some of our smartest people out there. And certainly, you know, some of the folks that we have in late night right now are really at the top of their game in terms of smart comedy. I think what Seth Meyers is doing, what Colbert is doing, I don't watch them all the time, but even Trevor Noah has some really smart takes that are also funny, and funny because they're smart. And, you know, Mrs. Maisel is the everyone's favorite show to be streaming right now, too. And she's brilliant and funny, and she does it without, like, being needlessly offensive. So, you know, it's an excuse, and it might certainly might even be true for some people, but I don't think that it justifies, you know, the attention that they later get or protects them from scrutiny once they've made it big and suddenly everyone's being like, hey, you said some really crappy things, you know, that you can't just get by. I mean, Ricky Gervais's most recent Netflix special had a whole bunch of stuff on trans issues that was really bad. And I personally actually had an exchange with him on Twitter over it where I was like, look, people don't get that you are playing a dumb, offensive character when you're doing this sort of comedy, because you're saying things that a lot of people who aren't dumb or aren't intentionally offensive actually believe about trans people.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have, like, if you're going to use that kind of, you know, persona to talk about those issues, you have to do it in such a way that people realize you're doing a persona. It really just sounded like your basic run-of-the-mill person who doesn't know about trans issues and thinks that biology is what counts. And he was actually kind of receptive in the Twitter exchange. And so I appreciated that, because I think Ricky Gervais can be really smart and really funny at the same time. And he just kind of flopped on that set.
So Kevin Hart wrote some pretty homophobic, unfunny things on Twitter. He refused to apologize. Then he dropped out of the Oscars and apologized. He could have apologized, right?
Yeah.
And we accept an apology, don't we?
Well, that's the thing, is we want people to grow. We want people to learn how to be better allies, to not make the same kind of offensive mistakes in the future. But that's why we have call-out culture. It's, hey, you've actually been doing some damage, and you need to stop doing that damage. And it'd be really great if you actually care, if you could maybe do some things to undo some of that damage by doing some good. And so when your whole attitude is, hey, I thought it was funny, and it was funny at the time, so that's all that should matter. Well, no.
Right.
Like, that's just you being lazy and indignant. That's not actually how anything is going to turn out in your favor.
Well, I pity whoever has to go through my tweets.
Yeah, you know, I'm sure I have weird things in mind, too, but I'm just hoping that I never do anything important enough that anybody bothers to, because I can't be bothered to. And I actually still kind of care that it's all there. Like, someday after I'm dead, I want a biographer to go back and, like, look at these really inane things I was tweeting about when I was 25 and, you know, derive some great importance and significance from them.
Well, Zack Ford is the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. Can you stand the line, sir?
Of course.
Okay, great. Enjoying today's show, please remember to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, click on it, and then shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. I promise you, every penny we get goes towards keeping the show going. And if you're doing your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, hit the contact button. Let me know so I can thank you.